In 1942, the tide turned against the Axis forces in Egypt and Libya. In October, after regrouping and resupplying, the British 8th Army launched a major attack near the town of El Alamein. 2 weeks later, an Anglo-American force landed in the Vichy French territories of Morocco and Algeria. In a series of engagements, fought over the course of the following 6 months, the Germans and their Italian allies were squeezed remorselessly from east and west. After rallying briefly and brilliantly to inflict heavy casualties on the pursuing American Second Corps at Kasserine, they were finally driven through Tunisia to the coast. The defeat of the Axis armies in North Africa was to prove a devastating blow to Italy. Hundreds of thousands of her finest young men were lost during the course of the campaign. In their efforts to supply them, the Italian Navy and Air Force were also virtually annihilated, rendering Italy herself vulnerable to invasion. The long struggle for North Africa by providing American air, naval and ground forces with invaluable battle experience paved the way for the eventual reconquest of Europe. Early Italian reverses against the British in Egypt and against the Royal Navy in the Mediterranean prompted Hitler to reinforce his Italian ally with two crack German divisions under the command of General Erwin Rommel. In February 1941, Rommel's Africa Corps began disembarking in the main Libyan port of Tripoli. And in March, before these formations were either fully assembled or equipped, he struck quickly eastwards into Cyrenaica. The British position in Cyrenaica hinged on Mersa Brega, a natural bottleneck on the coastal plain. But contingency plans existed for a withdrawal along the coast to Benghazi in the event of a major Axis offensive. The attack opened on March the 31st, and the British, conforming to plan, began withdrawing northwards that night. Rommel now divided his forces into three columns. One of these he sent along the coastal highway through Bed of Fom towards Benghazi, while the other two struck across the Cyrenaican plateau towards Derna and Tobruk. Faced with the threat of encirclement, the British abandoned any attempt to defend Benghazi and began a frantic retreat east. On April the 10th, Rommel reached Tobruk and on the following day surrounded it on three sides. But for 7 months, the port's garrison held out, reinforced and supplied by sea. In November, a British relief offensive, launched from the Egyptian frontier, finally broke through and cleared the Axis once again out of Cyrenaica. But the respite was to be only temporary. Rommel's failure to capture Tobruk had placed additional strains on his already stretched lines of communication. By withdrawing, these lines were shortened, and many of the problems of supply peculiar to the desert were overcome. Both sides faced the same fundamental problem. Everything had to be brought in, mostly by sea, and then carried through the desert to the front. There were few roads, and those that existed were narrow, crudely surfaced, and often cratered by airstrikes or detonated mines. The further one side advanced, the longer and more vulnerable grew its lines of communication, while those retreating shortened theirs and thus resupplied faster and more efficiently as they withdrew. Axis lines of communication stretched through Libya to Tripoli, and from there across the Mediterranean to Italy. Though much shorter than the tortuous route via South Africa and the Red Sea, by which supplies were sent to the British, the Mediterranean sea lanes were far more perilous. Between Italy and Libya lurked submarines and surface raiders of the Royal Navy. But the principal threat to Axis shipping came from British air patrols flying from Malta. The island was seen by both sides as the key to strategic control of the central Mediterranean. It had been bombed within hours of Italy's entry to the war, and plans had been drawn up for an Axis invasion. But in late 1941, a huge effort was mounted to starve the island into submission. Luftwaffe fighters and bombers, redeployed from Russia, joined those of the Italian Air Force in a murderous onslaught, both against Malta itself and against Allied convoys running supplies to the island. The renewed pressure on Malta brought a period of respite to the Axis convoys supplying Rommel. In January 1942, when enough supplies had been amassed and his depleted divisions adequately reinforced, he seized the opportunity to mount a quick counter-offensive. As they had been 9 months previously, the British were caught completely by surprise, and the costly gains they had won in the autumn were swept away as the Axis forces, spearheaded by the Africa Corps, stormed back onto the Cyrenaican plateau. From early February through to May, both sides faced each other across a line running from Gazala on the coast to the fortified village of Bir Hakeim on the desert flank. On the British side, the front comprised fixed infantry positions protected by wire and minefields. Behind these were five tank brigades and three motorized infantry brigades, deployed on the open flank. For the coming offensive, Rommel deployed two armored and one motorized division, supported by two weak Italian armored divisions. These would be launched against the British positions in the south, on either side of Bir Hakeim. After a night march through the desert to the south of Bir Hakeim, the main Axis striking force swung northeast and crashed into the rear of the British positions. What followed was a furious and often uncoordinated series of skirmishes as opposing mobile formations wheeled and clashed over the battlefield. Gradually, German battle experience and their more effective use of armor and anti-tank weapons proved decisive, wearing down the British armor and overcoming their exposed infantry. By mid-June, after nearly three hard weeks of fighting, the Germans finally broke through and began driving towards Tobruk and the coast. The second siege of Tobruk lasted no more than a few days. Although well garrisoned, its defenses had either been neglected or stripped to provide depth for the Gazala line. By June the 21st, the port had fallen, netting Rommel more than 30,000 prisoners, as well as vast quantities of fuel, equipment, and supplies. From Tobruk, Rommel quickly resumed his advance eastwards, driving the British en route through Egypt. After a first disastrous stand at Mersa Matruh, the British fell back to the partially fortified Alamein line, 60 miles from Alexandria at the western end of the Nile Delta, and the last defensible position before the Nile itself. The Alamein position was a natural strategic bottleneck, where the coastal plain ended at the lip of a steep escarpment. At Alamein, the escarpment ran virtually parallel to the coast and marked the northern boundary of the Katara Depression, a region of impassable salt marshes stretching deep into the interior. The Alamein line, as it existed in June 1942, consisted of a number of fortified boxes on the coastal plain, manned by infantry and supported in the rear by artillery and by what remained of the armored and mobile forces. On June the 30th, as the British armor wheeled into position behind the infantry, leading elements of the Africa Corps began arriving in the area immediately to the west. On the following day, as soon as sufficient force had been assembled, Rommel attacked, driving in through the center of the front in a bid to outflank the Alamein box. Initially, the attack made good ground. German armored spearheads advanced almost unopposed for 3 miles. But the British had redeployed for a more strategic defense. And when these defenses were engaged, the attack quickly ran into difficulties. The British gun line proved devastatingly effective, and most of the fixed defenses were resolutely held. The battle was also fought hundreds of miles from the main Axis airfields, and the RAF enjoyed almost complete mastery of the skies. After nearly a month of hard fighting, with no significant gains, Rommel broke off the attack. He had reached the limit of his logistical capabilities, and without a dramatic increase in supplies, he could go no further. The iron law of logistics would now work in favor of his enemies. From the outset of his appointment as Prime Minister of Britain in May 1940, Churchill's military successes against the Axis had been few. He had admittedly led his people with firmness and determination through the period of defensive struggle that became known as the Battle of Britain. But military victories in the field had eluded him. In North Africa, at the outset of the conflict with Italy, a British force led by General Richard O'Connor seized Cyrenaica in a brilliant campaign and seemed poised to eject the Italians from Libya. But Churchill squandered this opportunity by transferring troops to Greece in a wholly futile attempt to bolster the country's resistance to a Nazi invasion. The subsequent disaster that befell the British in Greece and on Crete, resulting in the loss of nearly 30,000 men, gravely weakened the British position in North Africa and paved the way for Rommel's subsequent victories in the theater. The loss of Tobruk came as a particular embarrassment, undermining Churchill's credibility at home and abroad. If the situation could not be rescued by a British success at El Alamein, Churchill's reputation as a strategist would be ruined, and his stature as a world leader seriously damaged. The Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor had threatened to embroil America in a purely Pacific conflict, a turn of events that both Roosevelt and Churchill were agreed would lead to a wasteful division of resources. But Hitler's declaration of war on America 4 days later enabled Roosevelt to advocate a strong military partnership with Britain and a concentration of resources in the European theater. Initially, Roosevelt pressed for a cross-channel attack on the French coast. But as America stirred herself for the tasks ahead, it became clear that the necessary men and arms for such an undertaking would not become available until 1943 at the earliest. In the short term, America could best support Britain by providing naval support to the Royal Navy in the Atlantic and the Mediterranean, and by sending air and ground forces to help the British in North Africa. Roosevelt's commitment to this strategy, once agreed, remained solid, even in the face of protests and criticisms from some of his senior military commanders. North Africa was only ever of peripheral concern to Hitler. He had become involved in the conflict out of loyalty to his ally, Mussolini, and his growing despair at the Italian army's failure to maintain even a posture of defense in the region. Indeed, the alliance with Italy was increasingly being seen as a liability, and Italian adventures had already involved him in two unwanted and distracting conflicts. The Balkan campaign had disrupted his preparations for the attack on Russia, and North Africa was a continuing drain on German resources. Moreover, Hitler was aware that until the war in Russia could be brought to a conclusion, he could not afford the men and equipment necessary to conquer Egypt and the Middle East. With these overriding concerns, and little confidence in Italian arms, his instructions to Rommel lacked their usual vigor and aggression. Rommel's task was primarily to provide backbone and firepower for the Italian army and to bolster Italian defenses in the region. More alarmingly, Hitler took little real interest in Rommel's difficulties, gave him no clear objectives, and failed adequately to support his efforts to exploit British setbacks. When Mussolini brought Italy into the war in June 1940, he did so in the firm conviction that both Britain and France were on the verge of defeat, and that rich territorial concessions could be won easily and cheaply at their expense. He boasted of turning the Mediterranean into an Italian lake and of re-establishing the Roman Empire. But Mussolini's ambitions were far greater than anything his armed forces could reasonably be expected to achieve. In France, despite a hastily mounted offensive on the Alpine frontier, he achieved nothing. And in the Balkans, his army was easily defeated by the Greeks. The Mediterranean proved a similarly hostile theater. And after a series of setbacks involving the loss of 4 battleships and several cruisers, the surviving elements of the Italian fleet were restricted to coastal waters or occasional forays under heavy air protection. In Africa, Mussolini's attempts to profit from British weakness had also met with disaster. By the summer of 1941, he had lost Ethiopia, and what remained of his army was now under the command of a German general. If Rommel could not now deliver the elusive victories and the territorial conquests Mussolini had promised to the Italian people, his position as dictator might become untenable. The overall Allied strategy for the coming North African campaign was for mutually reinforcing offensives at either end of the continent. In the west, this would take the form of a seaborne invasion of the Vichy French territories of Morocco and Algeria. Prior to these landings, the British Eighth Army in Egypt would launch an attack on Rommel's positions to the west of El Alamein. If both operations were successful, the Axis forces in North Africa would be trapped and annihilated. The immediate objectives of the seaborne assault, codenamed Operation Torch, were three French North African ports outside the operational range of the Luftwaffe. The Algerian landings would be made on nearby beaches, and the ports of Oran and Algiers would then be taken by flank attack or by close investment. Landings in Morocco would take place at three different locations, those on the flank to deter relieving attacks from the north or south, while the center group advanced on Casablanca. Once the ports had been captured and the harbour installations secured, follow-up convoys would begin unloading the necessary transport and supplies to enable the assault forces to strike out eastwards along the coast towards Tunisia. The ultimate objective for the expeditionary force was Tunis, a strategically vital port on the Tunisian coast. From here, the Allies could strike south towards Libya or, through naval and air operations, completely sever the remaining Axis supply lines to Tripoli. The capture of Tunis would also render Sicily vulnerable to an Allied invasion, mounted from North African bases and supported by fighter squadrons based on Malta. While these plans were being drawn up, the British preparations for an offensive in Egypt were already underway. Reinforcements and supplies were flowing into Alexandria. One huge convoy, dispatched at the height of the crisis, brought more than 300 new tanks and self-propelled guns. Material superiority on the ground and in the air was considered essential to break through the hardening Axis defenses and guarantee victory in any subsequent battle of maneuver. At Alamein, the main attack would be launched between Deir el-Shein and the coast, the most heavily fortified sector of the line. In the first phase, the infantry would advance behind a rolling artillery barrage, knocking out forward defenses, strong points, and command posts, and clearing two corridors through the minefield. The armor would then move through these corridors and fan out to take up positions about 2 miles further on. There they would adopt a defensive stand, deflecting and repelling the expected counterattacks by German armored formations. Meanwhile, in the southern sector of the line, diversionary attacks would draw off Axis reserves and armor and prevent reinforcement of the northern sector. The critical, attritional phase of the battle would be fought principally by the infantry, crumbling the Axis defences in the north and destroying the mainly Italian infantry forces trapped behind the armoured screen. Once this had been achieved, the British would then be in a position to roll up the line north to south, or in the more likely event of an Axis withdrawal, launch their armour and mobile forces in hot pursuit through Egypt to Libya. Throughout much of 1942, Hitler's attention was focused almost exclusively on his great summer offensive in southern Russia. The operation had begun well. Two army groups had attacked across the Donets, smashing aside the weak Russian front and sweeping on over the Don steppe, east towards the Volga, and south into the Transcaucasus. The plan offered a solution to more than one of Hitler's problems. By seizing Stalingrad and Astrakhan on the Volga, he would sever the landlines between Russia and the outside world, isolate the Caucasian oil fields, and thus strangle the Russian war effort. With the front securely anchored along the Don and the Volga, the Red Army would be powerless to prevent the Transcaucasus falling into German hands. The drive south would bring the Wehrmacht to the Persian frontier and open a new front against the British in the Middle East. This would dangerously compromise Britain's strategic position and compel a major redeployment of British forces from Egypt to Persia, thus weakening Montgomery's front at Alamein and undermining the security of the entire region. Rommel could only wait while this titanic struggle raged in the east. The awkward position in which he found himself in Egypt was largely of his own making. In seeking to exploit British disarray, he had disregarded orders to halt on the Egyptian frontier and pushed on to the very limit of his logistical capability. From Italy to Tripoli was a distance of 600 miles. From Tripoli to El Alamein was a further 1,400 miles, over which the bulk of his supplies had to travel. Fuel and transport, already at a premium, were being greedily consumed in the Herculean task of getting supplies to the front. More than half the Axis forces in Africa, from logistics personnel to anti-aircraft gunners, were engaged in this effort. What little actually reached Rommel was barely sufficient for defense. To compound these difficulties, the British Desert Air Force was gradually achieving mastery of the skies, and the final leg of the journey was becoming the most difficult and costly of all. Chronic shortages of fuel, equipment, and supplies were to dictate not only Rommel's strategy at El Alamein, but his whole conduct of the campaign. The Axis defense lines at El Alamein consisted of extensive minefields, strewn with barbed wire, in such a way as to funnel attacking forces into predetermined lines of fire. The fixed defenses varied between 2 and 5 miles in depth and incorporated pillboxes, concealed firing points, and forward command posts. As the front wound its way southwards, it became weaker, and it was here that the main British attack was expected. To counter any breakthrough in this sector, Rommel had four armored divisions, two German and two Italian, but all were gravely deficient in battle-worthy tanks and in men, and there was insufficient fuel for a battle of maneuver. The available armor was therefore widely spread and would be fed piecemeal into the battle to plug breaches in the line as and when they occurred. At the end of September, Rommel returned to Germany for medical treatment and to press the High Command for greater efforts to supply his army. But the tide of battle in the Mediterranean was remorselessly turning against the Axis. In September, British air and naval forces based on Malta had sunk one-third of all Italian merchantmen bound for Libya. In October, the figure would be closer to a half. Of the tonnage actually landed, a large part would be consumed by garrison and rear echelon units. More would be lost to Allied airstrikes. As the inevitable battle approached, the defenders could do little but stockpile frantically the few supplies that actually reached the front. In May 1940, General Bernard Montgomery was serving as a divisional commander with the British Expeditionary Force in Belgium. When the Belgian army unexpectedly capitulated on May the 28th, Montgomery's 3rd Division sealed the breach and made possible the retreat to Dunkirk. Recognition of his skill and determination was to ensure his promotion to corps commander, and after his return to England, he was charged with the defense of the Kent coast. To prepare for the threatened German invasion, Montgomery introduced a number of measures, such as hard training regimes and reduced leave for officers. Although initially unpopular, these measures helped to improve morale and brought the corps to peak fighting condition. Montgomery arrived in Egypt on August the 12th, 1942. Though stabilized, 8th Army's front at Alamein was by no means secure, and his first task was to strengthen the defensive posture of the army and reinvigorate the troops. Montgomery brought to Egypt a reputation as a hard taskmaster. He was outspokenly critical of his predecessors, intolerant of their failings, and deaf to their advice. But he understood more clearly than they did the nature of the difficulties 8th Army faced and the pressing need for reorganizing and retraining before any major offensive could be launched. Within weeks of his arrival in Africa, Erwin Rommel was already building the reputation that would eventually establish him as one of the greatest battlefield commanders of World War II. Although trained as an infantry officer, he had quickly mastered the new science of armored warfare, achieving distinction as a panzer commander in France, before leading the Africa Corps in a spectacular blitzkrieg through Libya. His energy, imagination, and tactical boldness, which had so thoroughly bewildered 8th Army, won him international respect. Even Churchill was forced to admit that successive 8th Army commanders had simply been outwitted and outmaneuvered, and 8th Army veterans had come to see Rommel as almost invincible. In 1942, after the capture of Tobruk, Rommel was promoted to Field Marshal, the youngest in the German army, and the culmination of a meteoric career. But recognition of his achievements was not accompanied by adequate reinforcements and an increased rate of supply. And without these, his operational freedom was severely constrained. At Alamein, he faced a cruel dilemma. He could neither advance nor safely retreat. Only by defeating 8th Army in the coming defensive battle could he continue to hold the line, while pinning his hopes on Hitler's vaunted offensive in the Caucasus. As a career staff officer in the pre-war American Army, Eisenhower's organizational talents quickly brought him to the attention of General George Marshall, the Army's chief of staff and Roosevelt's principal advisor and strategist. In Washington, Eisenhower served as Marshall's subordinate, in charge of operational planning, and in 1942, he was sent to England to coordinate the American buildup for an eventual cross-channel attack. When the decision was taken to mount Operation Torch with a proportion of these forces, Eisenhower was the natural choice as commander-in-chief. Although inexperienced as a battlefield commander, his undoubted talents for diplomacy and delegation were regarded as essential attributes for the first major joint operation between British and American forces. The Allied forces for the coming Battle of North Africa consisted of two separate components. The Expeditionary Force, destined for assault landings in Morocco and Algeria, and the 8th Army, facing Rommel in Egypt. While 8th Army's task was clearly defined, the invasion force faced a number of uncertainties. The operation itself had no precedent in modern military history, and no one could confidently predict how the French would react. A hostile reception could have catastrophic consequences. There was a shortage of assault and landing craft, and logistics planning for beachhead supply was seriously deficient. Moreover, the operation had been hastily mounted, and insufficient time had been available to train the assault troops properly in amphibious landings. Much would depend on the attitude of the French and the success or failure of Montgomery's offensive in Egypt. By the end of August, Montgomery had largely completed his primary task of bolstering the Alamein defenses, and a last despairing effort by the Axis forces had been effectively stonewalled. Throughout September and October, all efforts were directed at rebuilding 8th Army's strength and preparing it for the coming offensive. Planning and preparations emphasized the cooperation of all arms, the tactical role of each company and unit, and the expectations placed on individual officers and men. Comprehensive training programs were established to prepare the army for the hard tasks ahead and to ensure the proper coordination of infantry and armor. The buildup of men and material continued steadily, and by October, 8th Army consisted of 10 fully equipped divisions, three of them armored. Montgomery now possessed overwhelming material superiority, not only on the ground, but in the air as well. The Desert Air Force had been heavily reinforced, and Allied air power was further augmented by the dispatch of American Air Force units to the Middle East. This tilted the balance of air power decisively against the Axis. As the 8th Army completed its final preparations, Allied airstrikes on Rommel's assembly areas and lines of communication became almost incessant. The American M3 medium tank was hastily commissioned in 1940 as an interim measure to provide the American army with a tank comparable to those possessed by European powers. The result was a curious hybrid, half tank, half self-propelled gun. The main armament was a 75mm gun mounted in a right-hand sponson with a restricted traverse and capable of firing both high explosive and armor-piercing ammunition. The fully rotating turret mounted a 37mm anti-tank gun and a coaxial machine gun. The M3 entered service with the 8th Army early in 1942 and was known as a Grant. Despite its strange configuration, high profile and comparatively thin armor, the Grant quickly proved superior to all other existing British tanks, though it still fell far short of the best German machines. The British 6-pound anti-tank gun entered service in 1941. Hitherto, the army had relied on a 2-pound weapon, which had proved ineffective in France and virtually useless against German face-hardened armor in North Africa. Like many British weapons, the 6-pounder suffered lengthy delays between design and production. And when it finally arrived, it was already being overtaken by improvements to German armored plate and by superior counter-engagement weapons. It also fired only uncapped shot, which had a tendency to shatter on impact. Nevertheless, the 6-pounder was a useful defensive weapon when dug in and could defeat most German tanks at up to 1,000 yards. The 6-pounder's replacement, a 17-pound weapon, was already in production, but only a few of these would see service in North Africa. Entering service in 1937, the Hawker Hurricane was a remarkably good aircraft for its time and was the mainstay of the RAF's fighter squadrons during the Battle of Britain. But as a fighter, it quickly gave way to the Spitfire and was gradually re-equipped as a ground attack aircraft. The Mark IIc, which appeared in 1942, mounted 4 20mm cannons and the D version, 2 40mm cannons and 2 machine guns. These aircraft were used extensively in North Africa against all sorts of targets, including shipping, supply columns and tanks. By October, Hurricanes equipped 13 squadrons of the Desert Air Force, and although not all were yet cannon-armed, most were, and they were already sowing havoc behind the lines. The 8th Army and its predecessor, the Western Desert Force, had fought under 6 different commanders in less than 2 years. Constant changes of command, endless restructuring, and the loss of thousands of their comrades in a succession of avoidable disasters had combined to bewilder and demoralize 8th Army's officers and men. Yet if the Army could be taught to believe in itself again, and was properly trained and prepared for the tasks ahead, Montgomery knew it had the experience, equipment, and manpower to win a decisive victory at Alamein. As the weeks passed, and it became clear that Montgomery knew his job and respected his soldiers, 8th Army quickly recovered both its strength and its morale. Of those forces destined for French North Africa, fully three quarters were American. In contrast to Montgomery's veterans, they were full of confidence and enthusiasm, but many had only been partially trained, and the American army still lacked cohesion and discipline. How they would perform in the field had yet to be seen. In August 1941, the German Africa Corps and the Italian 21st Corps were combined under unified command to become Panzer Group Africa. In January of the following year, the group was augmented by a further two Italian corps and one German mechanized division, and redesignated as Panzer Army Africa. Although theoretically a mechanized force, the army's mobility was constrained both by chronic problems of supply and by its large Italian infantry component. Indeed, so great were the army's demands and so meager its resources that for long periods of time it was entirely dependent on captured enemy supplies and equipment. By August 1942, fully 85% of its transport consisted of British and American vehicles, and British rations, fuel, and even heavy weapons all played their part in sustaining the Panzer Army in the field. Yet despite these deficiencies, the Army remained a formidable fighting machine. Its German component and its overall German leadership, which gave it vigor and tactical flair in offense, would ensure commitment, resolution, and courage in the coming defensive battle. The Mark III was originally designed to a 1935 specification for a main battle tank, intended for armored combat. Mass production began in 1939, and the tank saw service in Poland and France. But the 37mm gun proved ineffective against Soviet tanks, and was soon replaced by a 50mm weapon. Armor thickness was also increased, and technical improvements made to the quality of the plate. Although the Mark III was progressively outclassed in the East and relegated to the role of support tank, huge numbers were sent to Africa, where they provided the bulk of the Africa Corps' armored strength. The Mark III Special entered service in 1942, and was the last significant version of the model. Mounting a long-barreled 50mm gun, face-hardened armor, and extra plates, the Mark III remained in production until 1943 and served with distinction throughout the African campaign. The Italian army entered the war with a tank totally unsuited to its prescribed role. The M1340 and its later variant, the M1441, evolved from a series of light tanks with which Italian tank development had been mostly concerned. Lightly armored and underpowered, the tank was only really effective against soft targets. Indeed, in its general configuration, it betrayed design influences which were more suited to a colonial policing role than modern armored warfare. The 47mm gun, although adequate in 1940, could not be upgraded, and the four-man tank carried an excessive number of machine guns. Early models also lacked desert filters, and their engines suffered heavily from the corrosive effect of sand. Large numbers were captured intact after having broken down, and were pressed into predictably short service by the British. M13s and 14s equipped three Italian armored divisions, all of whom would see service in North Africa. The 88 entered service with the Wehrmacht in 1933 as a high-velocity anti-aircraft gun, but by 1942 had become the most feared anti-tank gun in the German arsenal. Although the 88 was first used against ground targets during the war in Spain, it was Rommel who first recognized the true potential of the 88 as an anti-tank weapon, employing it in adversity in France, and then modifying it for use as a pure anti-tank gun in North Africa. Whereas the British had always regarded anti-tank guns as defensive weapons, Rommel employed them in an offensive role, attaching mobile batteries to panzer groups. Time and again, British tank formations would be drawn into pursuing retreating German armor, only to find themselves impaled on a screen of 88s. In 1940, in the skies over Britain, the Junkers 87, or Stuka, had suffered heavily when engaged by single-engine fighters. But in ill-defended skies, it still remained a truly awesome weapon. As a dive bomber, the Stuka was highly accurate, and its attack sirens added terror to its more conventional repertoire. In the first years of the war, the screaming Stuka had achieved international notoriety and a reputation far beyond its actual capabilities. In North Africa, it had often benefited from German air superiority, and in such conditions was employed to devastating effect. In 1941, an improved version was brought into service, which had greater armor protection, a more powerful engine, and an increased payload. At Alamein, where the RAF held dominance in the air, the Stuka would not play a major role. But in support of an Axis withdrawal, or against Allied forces in French North Africa, it was still capable of inflicting serious damage. Despite the recent setbacks at Alamein and the approaching British offensive, the German soldiers in Rommel's Panzer Army remained confident of his leadership. Many were campaign veterans who had grown accustomed to the hardships and privations of desert service. They were generally well trained, courageous, and professional, and regarded themselves as an elite. Replacements, when they arrived, were incorporated within existing formations and units, learning the tricks of desert living and the techniques of survival from their comrades. But at Alamein, these normally difficult conditions were exacerbated by a serious water shortage. Virtually no fresh water was available at the front. Most of what there was came from old wells and storage systems on the desert coast and was often polluted. Water rations were barely sufficient for the army's needs. Drinking water was in short supply, and there was little left for washing or sanitation. Personal hygiene suffered, and jaundice and dysentery were common. Yet if the Germans were able to endure these difficulties with fortitude, the same could not be said of their comrades in arms. Italian morale had all but collapsed. The obvious inferiority of their equipment and the humiliations they had endured at the hands of the British were compounded now by disillusion, epidemics, and the recognition that they had become very much the junior partners in the alliance. It was these ill-equipped and predominantly infantry troops that would have to bear much of the force of Montgomery's planned offensive in the northern sector. As the final contest for North Africa loomed, Hitler's campaign in southern Russia was grinding slowly to a halt. The drive to the Volga had become bogged down in a desperate battle for the city of Stalingrad. And in the Transcaucasus, the retreating Red Army had established a defensive front among the ridges and peaks of the Caucasus Mountains. The range stretched east to west for nearly 700 miles. And the few mountain passes that existed were heavily defended. By October, snow and ice had made them virtually impregnable. There was now no prospect of a drive south into Persia in 1942. As the German-Italian Panzer Army prepared to meet the coming British offensive at El Alamein, the tide of battle in the central Mediterranean was at last beginning to turn. Throughout the first half of 1942, the island of Malta had been brought almost to its knees by a combination of air raids and attacks on convoys bringing essential supplies. In August, the pedestal convoy, the most heavily protected merchant convoy ever to sail, ran the gauntlet between Gibraltar and Valletta. Of the 14 merchant ships that set out, only 5 reached the Maltese port, but the supplies they carried were sufficient to maintain Malta in the fight. In October, the air attacks increased in intensity in a last desperate attempt to bludgeon the island into submission. But again, the offensive failed, and after 8 days of savage fighting, the Axis daylight raiders were driven off. The survival of Malta as a strategic air and naval base astride the main Axis lines of communication would ensure that the Panzer Army continued to suffer the chronic shortages that had blunted its drive through Egypt and brought it to a halt at Alamein in the summer. On the eve of the Battle of Alamein, the Panzer Army suffered from several disadvantages. Among them, the absence of its long-serving and highly respected commander, and its pronounced material inferiority in men, equipment, and supplies. But these were compounded by a complete lack of reliable intelligence. No one knew when or where the British offensive would open. Senior Axis commanders could do little but attend to their own sectors and hope that the blow, when it came, could be contained. On the British side, intelligence appreciations gave an accurate picture of their enemy's strength and general deployment, but only a rough indication of the depth of the Axis defenses. If these survived the initial assault, the offensive would have to be reinforced or even remounted with fresh troops in a different sector. In its final deployment, 8th Army consisted of three corps. The strongest of these, the 30th Corps, was commanded by Lieutenant General Oliver Lees. 30 Corps consisted of five infantry divisions and one armored brigade group. The composition of 30 Corps, which included divisions from Australia, New Zealand, India, and South Africa, reflected the commitment of the British Empire and Commonwealth to the battle. The southern sector of the line would be held by 13th Corps. This was commanded by Lieutenant General Brian Horrocks. 13 Corps consisted of three divisions, of which two were infantry and one armored. 13 Corps would mount diversionary attacks in support of 30 Corps' main offensive in the north. The 10th Corps comprised the reserve and consisted of two armored divisions under the command of Lieutenant General Herbert Lumsden. 10 Corps' task was to exploit the breaches torn in the enemy's front by 8th Army's infantry. Air support would be provided by the Desert Air Force, commanded by Air Chief Marshal Sir Arthur Tedder. Tedder's squadrons would be required both to protect and support 8th Army in its efforts. Facing these forces, the Panzer Army was commanded, in Rommel's absence, by General George Stummer and consisted of three Italian and one German corps. The Italian 21st Corps was stationed in the northern sector and was commanded by General Ennio Navarini. 21st Corps consisted of two infantry divisions, both of which were deployed in depth behind extensive minefields and fortifications. The Italian 10th Corps, deployed in the south, also consisted of two infantry divisions. 10th Corps was commanded by General Eduardo Neba, who expected the main British attack to be launched in his sector of the front. The Italian 20th Corps, commanded by General Giuseppe De Stefanis, contained some of the best formations in the Italian army. 20th Corps consisted of four divisions, of which three were held in tactical reserve. The two armored divisions close to the front, the motorized division further back. The Folgore Parachute Division was deployed on the extreme southern flank. The Panzer Army's main striking force, however, was the German Afrika Corps, consisting of two panzer divisions, one mechanized division, and one infantry division. The Afrika Corps was commanded by General Wilhelm Ritter von Thoma. Von Thoma's infantry, along with detached elements of 15th Panzer and one brigade of paratroops, were defensively deployed, while the mobile components provided a tactical reserve. Air support for the Panzer Army would be provided by the 2nd Air Fleet based in Italy and commanded by Field Marshal Albert Kesselring. Kesselring's air fleet, however, had responsibility for the entire Mediterranean, and most of his resources would be devoted to keeping open the Panzer Army's lines of communication. When the 8th Army completed its final deployments on the eve of Alamein, it had already won the Battle of Supplies. It possessed a 2-to-1 material superiority in men, and in tanks, guns, and aircraft, the difference was even more pronounced. To a large extent, the unsung heroes of the conflict in North Africa were the officers and men of the Royal Navy, and the soldiers, civilians, and airmen on Malta. By their efforts in the central Mediterranean, they had rendered the Panzer Army virtually immobile and ensured that the coming British offensive would have the best possible chance of success. At precisely 9:40 p.m. on October the 23rd, 8th Army's artillery announced the beginning of the Battle of El Alamein. For 15 minutes, nearly 1,000 guns pounded the Axis rear areas. Then, after a slight pause for relaying, they began laying down a curtain of fire on the forward defenses. As the barrage rolled gradually through the minefields, the infantry attack went in. The main attack was launched on a narrow frontage by four divisions: the 9th Australian, the 51st Highland, the 2nd New Zealand, and the 1st South African. Facing them, the Italian Trentino Division and the German 164th Division held strong defensive positions in the complex of fortifications and minefields that lay to the north and east of the Mitteria Ridge. These forces were supported by the Italian Armored Division, Littorio, and by 15th Panzer. Advancing behind the barrage, the British infantry and sappers quickly made good ground, cutting paths through the barbed wire and picking their way tentatively through the minefield. The first objective was a line drawn on the field maps halfway through the Axis defences and known as the Red Line. This was reached at around midnight in most sectors, and then there was a short pause while the front was consolidated, companies regrouped, and second wave battalions came up to take over the lead. While this was being carried out, the artillery barrage fell on the Axis positions to the west and southwest, rolling forward from the Red Line to the night's final objective, the Oxalic Line. This ran along the far side of the Mitteria Ridge and then swung north towards the coast. In the remaining hours of darkness, the infantry advanced towards these objectives, while the sappers cleared two corridors through the minefields behind them. As the night progressed, however, and the German-Italian defenders recovered from their shock, the attack began to lose momentum. And daybreak found the British holding positions in most sectors slightly short of the Oxalic Line. On the 24th, the British made several attempts to pass their armour through the minefield corridors to the Oxalic Line, but all were frustrated, either by uncleared mines or by highly accurate German anti-tank fire. This was a serious setback, indicating that the German defences were much deeper than the British had anticipated. The same fate, for much the same reasons, befell the diversionary attacks launched by Horrocks' Corps in the south. But these operations, despite the high cost in casualties, achieved their primary objectives, engaging 21st Panzer and holding it in the southern sector. On the Axis side, the situation, though serious, was not yet desperate. The chaos and disorganization that had followed the opening barrage was gradually being brought under control. General Stummer had been killed in the first few hours of the attack, and von Thoma had taken temporary command until Rommel could reach the front. Despite heavy casualties, the front had held, and the main Axis gun line still remained intact, safely west of the Oxalic Line. For the remainder of that day, and most of the next, the fighting raged incessantly. On the 26th, Rommel transferred 21st Panzer from the south to buttress the defences in the northern sector. By now, the main thrust of the British attack had become obvious. The weight of shellfire alone betrayed their plans. But the redeployment of Axis armour west of the Oxalic Line threatened to block this thrust, or at the very least, seriously disrupt Montgomery's timetable. Over the next few days, there was particularly heavy fighting in this sector. On the 27th, 21st Panzer launched a counterattack north of the Materia Ridge, and 90th Light, brought up from reserve, attacked an Australian penetration towards the coast. Neither of these efforts were successful, but the violence of the assaults prompted Montgomery to reinforce Australian operations on the flank, in the hope of halting the build-up of Axis forces in the centre and draining Rommel's last reserves. By the end of October, the British had carved out a large salient anchored in the south along the Materia Ridge and in the north on high ground known as Point 29. To prevent any further exploitation of the salient, Rommel had deployed all four German divisions in a line of containment, stretching from the ridge to the coast. On October the 28th, Australian infantry, supported by elements of the 10th Armoured Division, launched an attack from Point 29 towards the coast. The operation secured a wedge of territory about a mile and a half long, from which further attacks were launched 2 days later. These operations gradually drew more and more German strength to the area. In particular, 21st Panzer was being slowly dismantled. Some units placed in reserve, others thrown into holding the coastal corridor. The southern sector of the line was now held almost entirely by Italian formations. Inside the salient, Montgomery had been busy reorganizing his forces. The New Zealand 2nd Division was redeployed across the rear of the 51st Highland to take up positions vacated by the Australians attacking to the north. Part of the 50th Division was sent forward to reinforce the Highlanders, and the South Africans took over the defense of the southern shoulder. On November the 2nd, after another heavy artillery barrage, the three divisions in the center of the salient, supported by the 1st Armored Division, together with parts of the 7th and 10th, attacked towards the flank of the German positions at their vulnerable junction with the Italians. By midday, the British had punched a hole in the Axis defences nearly 2 miles deep. Their leading infantry and tanks were engaging the last significant defences before the open desert, a screen of German anti-tank guns situated on high ground to the west. Behind the guns, what remained of the Axis armour was assembling in preparation for a counter-attack. The attack was launched from the northwest against the tanks and guns of the 1st Armoured Division. Both sides suffered heavily, but Axis reserves were by now exhausted and losses were irreplaceable. By the end of the day, the Africa Corps was reduced to 35 fit tanks. As yet, however, there was still no sign of a breakthrough. Repeated attacks by British armour and infantry continued to meet with fierce resistance. But the gradual process of attrition was taking its toll. The Axis front was now little more than a thin crust. Much of what remained of the Italian infantry had begun withdrawing on the 3rd, leaving only scattered rearguards to hold the line. In the center and north, the front was held by Africa Corps veterans, supported by the Italian Ariete Division. These forces, however, were exhausted, hungry, and short of ammunition. Efforts to fall back in stages had been frustrated by lack of transport and by remorseless British pressure. On November the 4th, von Thoma was captured, fighting alongside his men in the front line. Huge gaps were now being torn in the Axis defenses, and further fighting had become futile. Late that afternoon, Rommel bowed to the inevitable and authorized a full-scale withdrawal. That night, under cover of darkness, the last remaining rearguards slipped away to the west, leaving the field of battle to their enemies. While the battered remnants of Rommel's Panzer Army struggled westwards, under almost incessant attack from the air, the second great blow to Axis power in the Mediterranean was about to be delivered. In the waters off Morocco and Algeria, the fleet task forces of Britain and America, consisting of some 400 ships and more than 100,000 men, were approaching the French-held coast. As darkness fell on October the 7th, the warships and transports moved up to their assembly areas a few miles offshore. Remarkably, the fleet had sailed from its various ports of embarkation without losing a single vessel, and as the assault troops began disembarking, there was every indication that the element of surprise remained complete. Certainly, some efforts had been made at the highest level to enlist French compliance, but as the assault boats moved to their jumping-off points, no one could be confident of their success. The most violent reaction came, as Allied planners had feared, from French naval units, who were known for their pro-Axis sympathies. In all three target sectors, coastal batteries engaged the invasion flotillas, and at Casablanca, these were joined by French naval guns, including those of the battleship Jean Bart, still under construction. RAF fighters and bombers were sent from Gibraltar to provide extra cover to the landings and to attack the French warships. By comparison, the resistance offered by French colonial garrisons was light, and in many instances, merely token. On the landing beaches, the greatest hazard was the unpredictable tide and surf and the inexperience of the boat handlers. Over the course of the day, more landing craft would be lost through accidents, broachings and collisions, than to enemy fire. Off Casablanca, the naval duel continued for several hours, and it was here also that the Allies encountered determined fighting on the ground. North of the town, the beaches were stoutly defended, and French aircraft made several strafing runs, adding to the casualties and compounding the confusion of the beachheads. Allied carrier-borne aircraft joined those flown in from Gibraltar, gradually chasing the inferior French machines from the landing areas. By noon, most of the seaworthy French warships had been sunk or disabled, and the guns of the immobile Jean Bart had been put out of action by a well-aimed salvo from the American battleship Massachusetts. French aircraft still appeared intermittently in the area, but as yet, no task force vessel had sustained significant damage. Of the three French ports strategically targeted for early seizure, Algiers proved the easiest and was captured with its harbour facilities intact on the first day. The port of Oran, however, proved more difficult, partly due to the failure of two key components of the plan. The main Allied landings took place on the flanks, in comparatively quiet coastal sectors east and west of Oran. These were largely unopposed, and beachheads were soon established. But a raiding party, in two light vessels, was sent in to secure the town's harbour complex by a surprise frontal assault. These were engaged by shore batteries and by French warships in port, and both vessels were quickly destroyed. A further component of the plan called for the quick capture of two airfields, situated to the southeast of the town. These were to be taken by airborne forces flown from England, but the long distances involved, combined with bad weather and poor organization, resulted in most of this force landing on the dry bed of a salt lake, too far from their objectives and too dispersed to have any effect. The southernmost airfield was eventually taken by flying columns arriving from the coast, and a few hours later, two squadrons of Spitfires were flown in from Gibraltar. On the following day, the northern airfield was captured by American armored units pushing along the north edge of the Salt Lake, and by nightfall, Oran and its coastal defenses were completely cut off. On the following morning, battleships and cruisers of the task force engaged the seaward defenses while the infantry and armor cut their way into Oran from the rear. The fighting lasted only a few hours, and by midday, the town and its port were in Allied hands. That afternoon, the French North African commander, Admiral Darlan, ordered a general ceasefire, bringing the fighting in Morocco and Algeria to an end. For the Allied commanders, the main priority now was the occupation and consolidation of French Tunisia, and elements of General Anderson's First Army were sent eastwards by land and sea to seize the East Algerian ports of Bougie and Beaune. But the battle for Tunisia was destined to be a long and bitterly fought contest. When reports of the Allied landings had first reached him, Hitler had ordered troops to be scraped together and sent by air transport to take control of the key Tunisian airfields and ports. The first German units arrived on the following day, along with some 40 German combat aircraft. Over the next few days, more would be flown in, and a powerful German bridgehead established in Tunisia. On the 11th, Bougie was taken without resistance, and British and American troops began disembarking. Later that day, however, German aircraft flying from Tunisia swooped down on the transports. The attacks persisted for 3 days, sinking several ships and damaging others, and destroying huge quantities of equipment and supplies. Beaune was taken on the 12th, again without resistance from the French. and forward elements of First Army were probing the Tunisian frontier. But on the same day, the first Axis naval transports arrived in the Tunisian port of Bizerta. Thousands of Germans were now pouring into the country, clearly intending to occupy it as a forward strategic base. By this time, Vichy France itself was under German occupation. And on the 13th, the French garrison forces in Morocco and Algeria were rearmed and placed under Allied command. The withdrawal of Rommel's Panzer Army from the Alamein positions had been undertaken only in the face of its imminent destruction and at the last possible moment. Inevitably, much had been abandoned, including a large part of the Italian infantry, through an acute shortage of transport. But the more mobile German divisions, although considerably depleted, had escaped with at least some of their equipment. From Alamein, these units fell back along the unbroken coastal highway to Fouca, some 50 miles to the west. British pursuit was initially hampered by traffic jams and by the inevitable logistical difficulties of processing large numbers of casualties and prisoners. Axis rear guards deployed on the desert flank compounded these problems, and German air units sought every opportunity to harass and disorganize the British. Clearing up and salvage occupied engineering units that might otherwise have been available for minefield clearance. These still presented problems, not only in the Alamein sector, which in some places was still heavily mined, but also at Fouca, where an old, unmapped minefield held up the pursuit for several vital hours, enabling Rommel to pull back a further 50 miles to Meursault-Matru. From Meursault-Matru, rain and mud hampered any further attempts to cut off the retreating Panzer Army by outflanking movements through the desert, and efficient German demolition teams and rear guards hampered direct pursuit along the coast. On November the 10th, less than a week after the retreat began, the surviving elements of Rommel's army crossed over the Egyptian frontier to Libya. 2 weeks later, they reached the Mersa Brega positions, from where they had set out to conquer Egypt almost a year before. Meanwhile, at the other end of the continent, the follow-up convoys were unloading stores and equipment and disembarking fresh troops. Huge stockpiles were built up to sustain the Allied forces in their drive east. Airfields, roads, and supply depots had to be constructed, often from scratch, and additional rolling stock brought in to augment the dilapidated French railway system. As the runways were laid, hangars erected, and control systems established, more and more aircraft were flown in. But the carefully planned Allied schedule was rapidly being overtaken by events. Although the Allies had pushed small forces into Tunisia within a few days of the landings, they had failed to capture the key strategic ports of Tunis and Bizerta. These were now firmly in German hands, and the French garrison forces disarmed or driven into the mountains. The German buildup in Tunisia threatened to dislocate the Allied strategy of cutting Rommel's lines of supply. Indeed, the ports of Tunisia were much closer to Italy than those of Libya, the sea lanes more secure, and the bridgehead easier to maintain. In December, Allied spearheads that had come to within 10 miles of Tunis were thrown back, consolidating the bridgehead and securing all the major Tunisian ports and harbors under Axis control. December also brought rain, which fell most heavily in the northwest, flooding roads and turning the battlefield into a sea of mud. By Christmas, further advances had become impossible, and a wretched stalemate settled over the front. In December, Rommel abandoned the Mersa-Brega positions and began a phased withdrawal to Burat. In mid-January, he fell back again, this time to the Tunisian frontier, evacuating Tripoli en route. Eighth Army reached Tripoli on January the 23rd, an advance from Alamein of some 1,400 miles. Although Rommel and the remnants of his force had escaped capture or destruction, Montgomery could take comfort in the fact that he had given the Panzer Army a sound thrashing, destroying more than half of it, and driving the Rump in full retreat through Egypt and Libya. In Tunisia, rain and mud continued to hamper operations throughout much of January. This was particularly true in the north, where neither side was able to make any headway. In the south, however, the Germans launched limited attacks to seize key passes in the eastern dorsal. These gave access onto the coastal plain and were only lightly defended, mainly by French North African forces. Lacking effective anti-tank guns, the French were easily overwhelmed, and American efforts to come to their aid were thrown back. The Germans at this time were also active in the air, where they enjoyed several advantages, including all-weather runways and overall air superiority. German efforts were focused on disrupting the Allied buildup, harassing their lines of communication, and damaging or destroying their forward airfields. Air superiority allowed the Germans to employ their Stukas to maximum effect, and swarms of these aircraft raided with impunity in the first months of the campaign. Throughout the battle for Tunisia, Allied efforts on the ground would be continually menaced by these attacks, and huge numbers of their own fighters would be lost in the desperate battle to achieve parity, and eventually dominance in the air. At the end of January, the last key strategic pass in the eastern dorsal fell to 21st Panzer, Rommel's veteran desert formation, which had been hastily re-equipped on its arrival in Tunisia. With the capture of the Faid Pass, the Germans had achieved all of their initial objectives, the consolidation of a powerful bridgehead and the concentration of their forces. They were now in a position to seize the initiative and launch a major offensive of their own. The focus of this effort would be the American Second Corps, holding the most southerly sector of the line. Second Corps was deployed in three armored battle groups, holding a discontinuous front. On February the 14th, 21st Panzer advanced out of the south, driving northwest towards Sidi Bouzid. 10th Panzer, meanwhile, which had taken over 21st Panzer's positions in the eastern dorsal, attacked out of the Faid Pass, driving due west. Caught between these pincers, the Americans fell back in confusion, and on the following day began a general withdrawal to the line of the western dorsal, some 50 miles to the rear. On the 15th, the attack was joined by a German battle group consisting of the Africa Corps' remaining mobile formations. But by the 18th, the American withdrawal was complete, and the danger appeared to be averted. On the 19th, however, after pausing to reorganize and resupply, the Germans resumed their offensive. 21st Panzer advanced towards Biber, while the Africa Corps Battle Group and 10th Panzer assaulted the pass through the western dorsal at Kasserine. The pass fell early on the 20th, and by the afternoon, German armor and mechanized infantry were pouring through the western dorsal onto the comparatively flat plains beyond. Ahead of them lay two key towns, Thala, a vital link in the Allied system of north-south communications, and Tabessa, a major Allied supply dump in eastern Algeria. The speed of the advance was reminiscent of Rommel's early blitzkriegs in Libya and Egypt, and sent a panic through the Allied high command. If the Africa Corps and 10th Panzer reached the Algerian frontier and broke through into the rear of the battle zone, they could wreak unimaginable havoc, perhaps even precipitate an Allied collapse. Blocking forces were scraped together from wherever they could be found. Artillery and tanks were rushed to the area, and Allied ground attack aircraft operated around the clock. Savage fighting, confusion, and fear characterized these engagements. The Allied blocking forces were ad hoc commands consisting of elements from different units and divisions. Britons, Americans, and French fought side by side, commanded by whichever officer happened to be nearest. For their part, the Germans were equally determined to break through and kept up the pressure relentlessly. But they had now advanced for 100 miles, and their supplies of fuel and ammunition were running low. The Allied blocking forces, on the other hand, were fighting only a few miles from their main bases and lines of communication, and were being rapidly resupplied and reinforced. Gradually, the tide of battle began to turn. The Allied lines held, and on the 22nd, the Germans disengaged. Having lost the initiative, Rommel could do little but order a complete withdrawal. The brave gamble had failed, although only just, and the panzer groups would soon be needed to buttress the southern defenses against Montgomery's 8th Army. Forward elements of 8th Army had reached the Tunisian frontier in early February, capturing Medinine on the 16th and closing on the Axis defenses at Marath. By mid-March, the army had assembled in strength, and Montgomery's plans and preparations for a drive north were now complete. The key to Rommel's southern defenses was the Marath Line, a complex of interconnecting fortifications built by the French in the 1930s. These ran from the coast near Marath to the Matmata Hills, through which there were few passes. West of the hills, however, there was open desert leading to the Tabaga Gap and the town of El Hama. Long-range reconnaissance confirmed a route through the desert leading to the gap. Montgomery planned to send the New Zealand Division with attached armor through the desert to assault the gap. While this wide flanking maneuver was being carried out, the Marath Line would be engaged by frontal assaults
mounted by 30 Corps, consisting of the 50th Division, the 51st Highland, and the 4th Indian Division. In reserve were the two armored divisions of 10 Corps. These would exploit whichever axis of attack seemed most promising and pursue the retreating forces northwards. Holding the Marath line, Rommel had four infantry divisions of the Italian First Army, buttressed in the center by the Africa Corps veterans of the 90th Light and protected on the flank by those of the 164th Division. Behind these, in tactical reserve, was 15th Panzer. But behind the Marath line, Rommel also had a second potential line of defense before the open plains of central Tunisia. Near Gabus, the impassable salt marshes of the Shott el Fajaj came to within 20 miles of the coast. If dislodged from the Marath positions, Rommel planned to withdraw only as far as this line, where 10th and 21st Panzer were held in strategic reserve, ready to deploy in support either of the Marath line or of the Gabus positions. Montgomery, however, had requested diversionary attacks to be launched out of the Western Dorsal by the American Second Corps. By demonstrating towards the coast, Montgomery hoped that Second Corps would draw off the Panzer Reserve. Despite Allied concerns about the combat readiness of Second Corps, the American attack was amongst the most successful of all the preliminary operations. Advancing out of the Eastern Dorsal, the Americans quickly overcame light opposition, capturing Gafsa and driving some miles down the road leading from Gafsa to the coast. 4 days later, they seized Macnassi in the Eastern Dorsal and pushed out patrols into the surrounding hills. Meanwhile, Montgomery's operations in the south had met with mixed fortunes. The main attack on the Marath positions had become bogged down in heavy fighting, and a bridgehead, won by the infantry, was counterattacked heavily by 15th Panzer. West of the Matmata Hills, the New Zealanders had stormed the entrance to the Tobaga Gap, but any further exploitation was soon frustrated by the arrival of strong enemy reserves. The Americans, southeast of Gafsa, were also attacked by 10th Panzer. But 2nd Corps, now commanded by General George Patton, was determined to avenge the humiliations of Kasserine and fought with skill and determination, throwing back 10th Panzer's attack with heavy casualties. Montgomery now switched the focus of his efforts from the Marath line to the Tobaga Gap, sending 1st Armour to help force a way through. Air support was called in, and the gap was saturated with air and artillery bombardment. In the first phase, tactical bombers added 400 tons to the weight delivered by the artillery. Then ground attack aircraft screamed in from the southwest, 30 of them every 15 minutes, flying almost at head height and shooting up everything that moved. While these operations were in progress, 30 Corps maintained pressure on the Marath line, holding down 15th Panzer and preventing any further Axis reinforcement of the Tobaga Gap. On March the 27th, the New Zealanders and 1st Armoured, bludgeoning their way forward, were almost clear of the gap. Resistance on 30 Corps' front now diminished significantly as the Axis defenders began falling back towards Gabus. By the 29th, the fighting in the gap and battle for the Marath line was over, and British armor was driving through El Hamma towards the Gabus line, the last major obstacle before the open plains of central Tunisia. In the west, Second Corps' progress had been checked by the arrival of 21st Panzer, but the American attack had now achieved all of its original objectives. The Panzer Reserve had been drawn east at a critical phase in the battle, and then held down in savage fighting, leaving the Axis with no strategic reserve in southern Tunisia. The Gabbas positions proved much less formidable than might have been expected, partly because there had not been enough time to prepare them properly. The battle lasted for little more than a day. A breach gouged by 8th Army's infantry in the center of the front was once again plugged by 15th Panzer. But against the withering fire of 8th Army's artillery, there was no hope of holding it closed for long, and there was nothing left in reserve. That night, the battered Axis divisions disengaged and fled to the north. From Gabbas, the remnants of the once feared Panzer Army withdrew across the plains of central Tunisia to the comparative safety of the hills surrounding Tunis and Bizerta. Attempts to cut these forces off by attacking through the passes of the eastern dorsal were unsuccessful. But the clearance of central Tunisia gave the Allies important new airfields and radically transformed the balance of air power. From these new forward bases, the Allied air forces were able to mount a systematic offensive against Axis supply ships and against the ports and harbors in the Tunisian bridgehead. In April, the tonnage actually landed in these ports was less than half the required minimum, even for purely defensive operations. By contrast, the Allies had taken advantage of the winter stalemate to build up huge stocks of supplies and equipment, to build roads and airfields, and to amass the necessary men and arms for a decisive victory. The overwhelming material superiority the Allies now enjoyed enabled them to withdraw experienced units and replace them in the line with fresh formations, thus introducing untested soldiers to battle in the most favorable conditions. They also reorganized their command structure and redeployed on a huge scale, bringing up French and American forces for the final offensive, and thus ensuring that the victory honors would be shared equally by all the component nations of the military alliance. Yet despite this pressure and the hopelessness of their situation, the Axis defenders fought stubbornly, bitterly contesting Allied efforts to throw them out of their last mountain redoubts. South of Tunis, they held ideal terrain for defense, a tangle of hills and ravines where the eastern and western dorsal converged. West of Tunis, the line had remained static for months, and the Axis defenses were well organized and difficult to breach. Strong points and commanding heights had to be bludgeoned by artillery and then stormed by infantry. In late April and early May, the Axis bridgehead was hammered remorselessly. Some 16 Allied divisions mounted a series of coordinated offensives, while above them, the Allied air forces bombed, blasted, and strafed almost with impunity. In early May, the thin Axis crust began to crack, and gaps appeared as the defenders were driven back or pushed aside. On May the 6th, a concerted British effort southwest of Tunis rolled over 15th Panzer, virtually annihilating the veteran desert formation. The breach opened the road to Tunis and threw the Axis defenders into disarray. The last few days of the battle for North Africa saw disorganized and futile fighting in virtually every sector. Tunis fell on the 7th, as did Bizerta, but the fighting continued regardless. Hitler's orders to fight to the last man and the last round ensured that the battle was prolonged unnecessarily, and at the cost of hundreds of lives that might otherwise have been spared. South of Tunis, in the hills above Amphideville, the remnants of the Africa Corps held out until the 13th. They were amongst the last to lay down their arms. The final toll of prisoners taken in the closing days of the Tunisian campaign came to nearly a quarter of a million, half of them German. Some of these soldiers had never fired a shot and had only recently arrived from Europe, when the battle for Tunisia was all but lost. Such had been Hitler's determination to hold a bridgehead in Africa. The campaign in North Africa laid the foundations for future Allied successes on the continent of Europe. American soldiers had been tested on the battlefield, and after early setbacks had recovered well and fought bravely. The French North African forces had been brought back into the Allied camp, ending a long period of enforced neutrality and enabling the British and Americans to assume the mantle of liberators rather than of conquerors. A common Allied command structure was established, and the various component armies welded into one homogeneous force. But the greatest single achievement of the campaign was the scale of the victory. Two entire armies, one German and one Italian, had been utterly destroyed, and the last traces of Axis power and influence had been swept from the continent of Africa. Victory in North Africa also provided the Allies with a springboard for operations against Italy. In July, an Allied invasion of Sicily would quickly lead to the dismissal of Mussolini and efforts by the new Italian government to negotiate an armistice. These efforts were doomed from the outset. In September, Italy was in turn occupied by the Germans and invaded by the Allies. The ensuing battle for Italy would be one of the most protracted and bitterly fought contests of World War II.